like their, if you can remember from yesterday, process for coming up with the function? Unless you can tell me how you got the function, don't tell me what the function is.
Divide by 2.
Divide by 2?
I forgot what we did to find it, but I remember.
Y equals 2x minus 20.
Are you going to explain to me what
okay,
the function
is?
Like how you came up with this?
I came up with this.
Okay, so I want to hear.
Okay.
Someone tell me how they came up with the function.
So the base number is 150.
The base number.
Okay, so put 150.
Put 150.
Yeah, right there. Okay. Okay, now put plus.
Okay.
Now put a negative.
Leave room for an x there.
Put an x there. Is that right?
Put an x here?
Yeah. Okay, now put a negative 12.5.
Okay, you're going to tell me how you came up with this.
Okay, so, you know, half 25 is 2.5, and...
Why does that matter?
Well, because it's 2 of your 2 numbers, it goes up.
So x goes up by 2.
Yeah, and it goes down by 25.
And y goes down by 25.
Yeah.
Okay, so I heard you mention half of 25. Why half of 25?
Well, because if it was times 1, it'd be 12.5, so, you know.
So, am I right about this, that maybe you tried...
You have to make a number that's that goes down by 25 when it's times by 2. So
that's a good explanation. I'll just put that back over that way.
Yeah.
So you need to be able to plug in 2, right, and get a drop by 25, right, for 150. So this being 0, is that helpful?
Yeah, because we know that 0 is
it's
very close to 150. Like the input.
It gives you a starting point, right?
Yeah.
Start from here, and then I know when I plug in 0, I need to get this number, and then I need to go down from there, 25, if I plug in 2 for x.
So to find this is what we just do is we see how much it goes up to the next one, and then for the low we see how much it goes down or up, and then divide that number, since it'd be minus 25, wouldn't that just equal negative 25 divided by 2? Okay, so that's how we find it all.
Do you think that'll work every time?
Can we try it?
Let's try it. Let's try it for another one. Okay, so we notice if we're going to follow Bridger's advice, we're going to take note this goes
up by 5.
Up by 5, so plus 5. And this goes
by 2.
Up by 2. So Bridger's suggestion is that in order to find this number here, that you multiply x by, let's just divide this change in y by this change in x.
So 5 divided by 2.
5 divided by 2, let's see how this is. 5 divided by 2 times x plus something?
Plus
what? Now this is a little bit trickier because I don't have a 0 like we did in the last one, do we?
Plus 4, maybe, because that's the base number.
Plus 4 because there's a 4 here?
I don't know, I'm just guessing.
How can we find out?
Is it negative 5?
Is it minus 5?
Yeah.
Every 2 goes up, the bottom goes up 5.
Okay. How can we find out if Grace was right?
Plug it in,
right? So even if Grace isn't right, we'll find out. We'll figure out which number it should be. Right?
But
Grace,
how would we
feels
find
like it's already not right.
Mm-mm.
What do you think it is? Think it's positive 5. Here, let's just put plus.
Oh, we can go ahead.
Question mark.
Oh wait, I got this. Okay. So
right, and I'll just figure out what it needs to be.
Okay. I got this. So you can plug 4 in for x.
Plug in 4 for x.
And
five,
y is going to be
15. 4.
And then you're going to have it.
Y is
going to
be 15.
And
plus question mark.
It's positive 5.
Yeah.
And okay. Because 4 divided by 2 is 2. 5 times 2 is 10. 15 equals 10 plus question mark.
Oh. So how we find it is we just see what that equation equals because we know for sure that that's right, and then we either add or subtract to equal the next number.
Well, so far we think we're right because we started by following your advice, right? Just take, like see how much y changes and how much x changes and divide?
Mm-hmm.
So it certainly seemed to be the case for the last one, negative 25 divided by 2 is negative 12.
Then it would be 1. So the question mark could be 1.
Question mark would be 1? Let's see. 4 divided by 8, or 4 divided by 2 is 2, 5 times 2 is 10. 10 plus whatever this question mark is 15. So common sense tells us it's 5. Algebra tells us it's 5. We subtract 10 on both sides. We get the question mark is 5. You know what? We have a better name for that than question mark.
B.
Variable?
B.
Oh, no. Yes, B. to be fair, we're not sure that Bridger was right. How can we test to see if he's right? Plug it in. I mean, plug in every one of these. So we'll plug in 6, right? Let's see what happens. Y equals 5 halves times 6 plus 5. Y equals 6 divided by 2 is 3. 5 times 3 is 15 plus 5. Y equals 20. Yep. Okay. Well, you know what? If I were to replace this 6, because everything's the same except for what we plug in there. If we put an 8 in there, can 8 be divided by 2?
Yeah.
4 divided by 2. It's going to be 4 instead of 3, right? Now it's just going to be the next multiple of 5 and the next multiple. It's just going to go up by 5 every time. Isn't that what it's doing?
Oh, yeah. It is.
Okay, so, Molly?
Like the last one we had 0 for one of the x's.
Yeah.
And if you find that point by subtracting 2.
Go backwards.
Go backwards 2, and that would be 0. And then subtract 10 from 15, so it would be 0, 5.
Notice what we did when we solved for b this way. What did we subtract the last step?
10.
Right? Not a coincidence. Because that's exactly what we did like in the equation version of solving this problem that you use the table to solve. Right? Let's go back 4 from where we are for the x's, and we'll go back
10.
You know, 2 steps of 5. Right? We find the same b. So that definitely will work. It is a totally valid approach, and it's a good approach. So yeah, use the pattern. This is what we're doing. We're really just turning patterns into functions. That's exactly what Molly did.
Can we go back to the first one?
Okay, what are we looking at?
Why did we choose 150, like plus?
Well, it was convenient, right? What was convenient about this, Clint? How did finding 150, like how was that part very easy to figure out?
Because there was 0 there.
Because it gave us this 0, 150, made it really easy. We can tell that if we, you know, if we plug 0 in there, we should get 150. So in a way, it kind of gives us a starting place, start at 150, go up from there. That's, well, actually down from there, right? The y's go down from there.
So if, sorry to interrupt, but if it starts with 0 and then the output is a certain number, then we know for sure that we add, or if it's negative, then we subtract that number.
What do you guys think of that? Is that always true? Do you even understand what Bridger was saying? If the table is given with one of the cells is 0 for x, do we just know that that's the plus number that goes on the end?
It's
the y-intercept, right?
Oh.
If you're making these connections with our experience with linear equations and graphs, all that kind of stuff. Is there a connection between what we're doing here and linear graphs?
Mm-hmm. Because there's x and y. Well, I mean.
Okay, definitely. I would call that a loose connection,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Does there have to be a y at the end?
Does there have to be a y at the end?
Like a y adding to the number? Like plus whatever? Or can there just be like the.
Like, does there have to be a plus here?
Yeah, or could it just be like...
Not always.
Or could it just be like, 2 over 25 up there?
2 over 25?
Yeah, like for the answer, y equals 2 over 25. Like every 2, you roll up by 25.
Well, y is equal to 2 over 25.
Or negative 25.
2 over negative 25.
Yeah.
Well... It's a little different from this because negative 12.5 is. How is negative 12.5 different from this?
It's the same.
It's the same thing.
Just it's in fraction form. Oh, wait. No, it'd be negative 0.5 over 2.
Okay, so let's change that.
Oh, yeah, it meant like that, yeah.
Alright. Well, now the way it looks at this moment, y will never be anything other than negative 25 over 2. Y is always negative 12.
Put the x, so that would work.
Okay, so would that work? I mean, it wouldn't work for this table, because clearly this is going to work for this table. Could it work for some table?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So for that table, let's make like a new, we'll keep the same x's, but we'll see how that would change the y's. How would that change the y? What y values would we get? If you plug in 0 to this function, what would you get out? 0. Then we go to where?
2.
No, well, x would go to 2, but what would y do after that?
25.
Which one?
125.
Negative 25.
Oh.
What after that?
Negative 50.
Right, the pattern's the same, the y pattern's the same, x pattern's the same, just different numbers. So, yes, there could be a not plus anything, as long as, for x is 0, you have?
You have your, the plus, I mean, the y
is 0. X is 0, y is 0. That's what it would have to look like for it to be plus nothing. Which, really, if we wrote plus nothing, we can see again, it's our y-intercept, 0, 0. X is 0, y is 0.
If, like, it was plus 0, would we even have to put that in the equation since it really doesn't do anything?
Right, that's a good observation. You don't have to write plus 0, you just leave it.
Okay.
And we verified that, yes, this will continue this pattern. If I put in a number that's 2 bigger than the previous number, the y value that I get out will be 5 bigger than the previous y value. Because all that happens is the next x value that's 2 greater is going to get divided by this 2. That's going to leave a number that's 1 bigger than the previous number we got from doing that. That's going to get multiplied by 5, essentially what we have. Every time we plug in something that's 2 more than the last x value, we get the next multiple of 5. And then we add that to, well, 5. Right? Now we know that that's 5, so the function is 5 times x plus 5. That's our linear function. Okay, here's some great observing here. Now let's see if we can just continue to use that approach, right? Bridger's given us a good idea here. So we look at y, and y changes by how much?
2.
And x changes by how much?
2. Negative 2.
Yeah, it goes, right, it goes more to the right of the number line.
Mm-hmm.
It actually does go up by 2, and so does y value. Okay, so Bridger says, can we just take 2, right, from here, divide by 2 from there?
So it'd be 1x.
So that just is 1. So we get y is equal to 1x, right, x. Plus, if Clint is right, plus what?
B.
What would B be?
8.
8, right? Why 8?
Because
that's
zero.
Oh, yeah,
0,
8.
X, you know, 0 for x is a handy thing. Whether it's given, or maybe like we could use Molly's suggestion, is like work our way back or up to 0, wherever it lies on this table. Yeah?
So if there wasn't a 0, we would just follow the pattern?
We could just follow the pattern. There's another approach, a more like mathematical, algebraic approach, which would be, I'll show you on the previous one. But plus 8, I think, right, I put it together, Bridger's idea, and Clint had about zeros, and right, x is 0, giving us the y-intercept. Y equals x plus 8. I think that works. What do you think?
Yes.
You can always test it, right?
Right.
Okay, so we'll plug in negative 4. Negative 4 plus 8 is 4?
Yep.
It is 4. Negative 2 plus 8 is 6?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I'm starting to see every time I let x go up by 2, obviously y is going to go up by 2, right? Because all that's, the only thing that left is 8.
Right.
And the y value is going to go up by 2, because that's just putting a number that's 2 bigger in there. And not multiplying it by anything but 1. So put 2 more here. I get 2 more as my output. Range function in here. Okay, let's go back to this one. So, like Molly suggested, we could find that y-intercept, that 0, that x is 0, by just kind of tracing back almost in our heads. We're back to 0, that's going to require me to go back to 2 times, right? Total 4. So I'll have to walk backwards 5 and another 5, so just subtract 10 as we do that. The other approach was this. Essentially the same thing, just, you know, algebraic. Plug in 4, see what happens, knowing that this is what we're looking for. Solve the equation for b, we find that b is 5. So whether we trace it backwards, 5, or I guess back 5 would be 10, back another 5 would be back to 5, or plug in an x value that we know and a y value that we know we should get, and figure out what that plus number would have to be, what that b would have to be. Okay, so is this a linear function? Like, if I graph this, would it be a line?
Yeah.
How do you know?
Because it goes up equally.
it goes up like predictably, evenly.
Yes.
As X makes this move, Y makes this move, they make the exact same
thing.
Pattern, you know, like a stair step kind of a movement,
mm-hmm.
right? We talk about other functions do not do that. Almost all the rest of the functions, are, well, all the functions other than lines do not do that. They do not do like a stair step predictable thing like that. Anything that's a curve just doesn't follow that pattern. But this one does follow that pattern. So if I were to graph it, I can think, okay, over 2, up 2, over 2, up 2. That's going to make a straight line between all those points. So answer me this. Is this a linear function? Is this a linear pattern or is it a non-linear pattern? You decide. In your notes.
Well, because the, you know, it's not because it's, well, I guess. No. Not because you're going up on the top one, it's going from negative 2 to 0,
yep.
and then 0 to 4, just like, so you would have to have the 2 in there.
So this goes up 2, but this goes up by 4.
Yeah.
Oh.
See, because of that, it's not linear.
Wait, it goes up in a pattern, though. How does it?
Well, okay, let's look at the Y's, right? So this goes up by how much?
3.
Alright, and this goes up by 4, this goes up by
6.
6.
Well, you know, that's not like the previous table. This went up 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. This went up by 2, this always went up by 5. Does that mean this is not a linear pattern?
No, because it still has a conservation, but there's just two different things that happens to it.
It is linear.
It is linear, it is linear. Now we hear it is linear. Like,
could we just graph it?
If we were to just graph it. Okay, let's just graph it and see what it looks like. And that, right? That's the definition of a linear function. It looks like a line when you graph it. Mm-hmm. So negative 2, 0, 0, 3, 4, 9, 4, 9. Did I get that? Is that not right?
That's right.
I'm pretty sure that's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
Right.
That's right.
It's right, but it doesn't go along.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so it's
not
a line.
Yeah,
plus
it
is.
It's a little above.
6, 12.
It's completely in line.
No, you're not.
That is a line, Kyler.
That's a line.
Yes, it is.
6, 12.
Yeah, just do it.
Here, let's draw a line.
Kyler.
Let's use our straight line tool. See, okay, it goes straight line.
See, does
straight
yes.
line going.
Yeah,
so oh,
told you, Kyler.
Yeah.
That doesn't look very
now,
straight,
maybe, wait, to be fair, maybe it's an optical illusion. Okay? If it were a line, right, and we go over 2 and up 3,
uh-huh.
right? Right, and over 2
six.
And up 3,
yep.
over 2 and up 3. Now notice when I went over 2 and up 3, over 2 and up 3 again, it did get me
right,
right on a point that I graphed. So is it linear or not?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, it is.
Of course.
I was
how can we tell just all the way back at the table without having to graph it? How can we say, well, yeah, it is the same
pattern?
With?
There is a line connecting all the points.
Okay, so
it's
again,
straight.
without graphing.
Oh, how can we tell?
Can we tell just from the table?
It
well, yeah,
pattern.
Because it has a consistent pattern.
How so? Like, explain to me how
well,
it's consistent, because it seems like it's not, because it goes up by 2, then
and
by 4.
Every time
three, by six.
That goes up, goes up by 2, that thing will go ahead, and it goes up by 3, and then when it will go.
Yeah,
it's consistent.
It's the same.
You're almost there, you gotta walk me all the way through it.
Okay, so.
And this one goes up by 4.
So
yeah.
This one goes up by 6. How is that consistent?
It
well,
because
it
went up 5.
It goes up by 3.
4.
And then it, three, it times it.
What
by
you,
two,
okay.
Two,
Stuart,
two,
you're gonna go right by the 4.
Two, maybe,
right
four,
by the 4.
Four
yeah.
Three,
yeah.
Three,
four, yeah.
Nine,
I draw a line down to make another divide.
Oh, it
does. Right there?
Yes.
Down.
Okay, I'll put a 2 on the top.
Okay.
Now put a 6 on the bottom.
Okay.
And there we go.
Now this is 2, and this is 3. This is 2 again. And this is 3.
Oh yeah, they're just skipping.
I just skipped a point.
Yeah.
Ethan put it a different way. How did you put it?
Well, so it goes up by 2, and that goes up by 3, but then that goes up by 4, which is times 2, so it times it by 2 on the other side, because then it goes up by 6.
Uh-huh.
And then we back.
So going up by 2 and 3 is the same as going up by 4 and by 6, because
yeah.
this was just double the change, right? Okay. What about, so this would be 12, and this would be, that also, like, is that still linear?
Yeah, because it's still following the same thing.
Is it?
Yes.
Okay, this goes up by how much?
Six.
And this goes up by how much?
Nine.
Yeah, nine.
Is that the same?
Yeah.
Yes.
For both of Ethan's and Clint's explanation.
Can you explain it to me so that I can, like, really see it? I can really understand that it is the same chain.
I don't think it is the same. Oh, yeah, because with it going up by six, it would mean that it goes up by two, three times.
Okay, so it's like
and
three
it,
times as much change.
Yeah, and it by going up by nine is going up by three times.
Okay, so even though I'm doing a bunch of jumping around, it's linear?
Yes.
Okay, gang signs, no, no.
What?
Please pay attention.
Yeah.
And look at your feet on the floor. Turn this way. Point your eyes toward the board.
Okay. Okay, science.
Alright. So, hey, yeah, it just there seems like this change is the same. Now let's go back to what Bridger said. Can we just take this change divided by this change? 3.
Y equals 1
over
2. 5 x plus 3.
Okay. Well, is that the same as taking 6 divided by 4?
No. Well, yeah, because you could simplify it.
Simplify it down to what? 3 over 2, right?
Yeah.
And this guy, 9 over 6, is that the same?
Yes.
Simplifies as well to 3 over 2. And these are all the same. The ratio of what to what? What would we call this?
X.
Oh, the numerus or something?
Numerator, denominator?
Yeah.
Okay, but like, how would you describe what is 3 describing, what's 6 describing, what's 9 describing? It's telling you
y?
The output.
What about y? Not just y, right? Like, this is
change
y.
In
the
y.
Change in y. How much y changes? Which?
Delta y.
You guys remember delta y?
No.
Yeah.
Okay, well, a reminder, delta y means what?
Change.
The change in y, right? Delta is a letter we use in math and science to represent a change, something changed. Okay, so what would be here in the denominator then?
Delta
x, change in x. Right? Something maybe we learned, perhaps just memorized before, now we see it in a different form.
Mm-hmm.
I can just take the change in y divided by the change in x, that gives me my multiplier of x. Right? Or on the graph, what would we call this on the graph?
The slope.
Oh, yeah, it goes up 3 to the right 2. The right 2, that's 3. So y equals, we got our slope, our multiplier of x, plus, hey, look at that, that's handy, right? Plus what?
3.